Hey, praise God, right? Thank you, Lord, for bringing us here. We're just going to go ahead and just stand right now. We're going to give this time to the Lord. We're going to ask him just to bless this service so that he can, and his spirit can move in this place. So, Lord, we come before you. We just thank you. And as I say before, praise you. Praise you so much for just your life that you give us, the life that you allow us to live for you. So Lord, you don't have to let us live for you, but you allow us to. So Lord, I pray that we don't take it for granted. I pray that we bow ourselves before you and just acknowledge you as our King, as our Savior, as the rightful place that you deserve, which is first, right above us, Lord, our first love. We want to acknowledge you in every step, every move we make. Lord, I just pray that you let your spirit just flow freely through this place. Let our hearts conform to yours right now, and let us worship you, maybe like we haven't worshiped in a long time, Lord. I just pray that we worship you in spirit and in truth, and let your just power just come inside of us so that we can rely on your strength right now and just take that as we go forward, Lord. We love you. We thank you. We praise you. In your name I pray. Amen. Let's praise the Lord.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near, and I will fear no evil. For my God is with me, and if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Singing, oh no, you never let go, through the calm and through the storm. No, no, you never let go, and every high and every low, no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. And I can see a light that is coming for a heart that holds on, a glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, and if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear?
Let's do that to him.
Singing, oh no, you never let go, through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go, and every high and every low. No, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Yeah, I can see a light that is coming for a heart that holds on, and there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. I can see a light that is coming for a heart that holds on, and there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Singing, oh no, you never let go, through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go, and every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Singing, oh no, you never let go, through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go, and every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. You never let go of me. Will you unravel me with a melody? You surround me with the song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me, and love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave. Child of God. Oh, I am surrounded by the arms of the Father. Songs of deliverance, and we've been liberated from our bondage, Lord. We're the sons and the daughters, so let us sing our freedom.
Yes, Jesus, we praise your name, Lord. You are just so worthy to be praised, God. We thank you, God, for your faithfulness, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your peace, God, in the middle of the storm, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that in the hard times and the good times, that you are still God, And I pray, Lord, that we would be still and know that you are God. We praise you, Lord, and we worship you. The storm surrounding me, let it break. At your name, still call the sea to still. The rage in me is still every way. At your name,
Jesus, Jesus. Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Marie, call these bones to live, call these lungs to sing once again. All these lungs to sing once again. I will praise
Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear, oh Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Sing that again, Jesus.
Oh Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, Jesus.
Storm surrounding me, let it break at your name.
Amen, Lord. Thank you. We just thank you so much for giving us that peace. Your name is higher than any other, and that's why we love to shout your name, Lord. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you. We praise you, Lord. In your name I pray. Amen. Why don't you guys greet one another if you feel comfortable, and we'll be back with some announcements.
Just a friendly reminder to get here early to find a good parking spot. We have a few housekeeping items to talk about. Please, no children allowed running in the sanctuary or lobby area. Let's keep our children and others safe. Only water or hydroflask-like drinking containers allowed in the sanctuary. Thank you. It's that time of year again. Children's Ministry proudly presents its first ever drive-through harvest. God's love is sweet. So if anyone is interested in serving in this community outreach, we will be having a meeting today after service in the NPR room. We are also asking for candy donations of any kind. We only ask that candy would be individually wrapped. Look for donation buckets in the lobby. We look forward to serving alongside of you and blessing the children and the families of our community. Sunday night series in the Book of Acts, Jesus Christ Church in Action. Come on out and be blessed. Come join us every Sunday for fellowship, coffee, and snacks before service from 10 a.m. to 10:30. Meet new people, get personal prayer, better parking spots, and relax before service. On Monday, October 26, from 5 to 6 p.m., we will be praying for our election and our nation. Please come out and join us. We'll be here at First Love in the multipurpose room. Let's also set our alarms for 2 p.m. every day up to the election and take time to pray for our election and propositions. Looking forward to praying together. High school leadership meeting this Wednesday after service in the high school room. Past and present leaders, as well as parents of students or in the high school group, are welcome to come. Our prayer chain ministry is starting up a men's prayer chain group. This group will also serve at other areas where praying is involved. If you enjoy praying and praying for others or feel like God is calling you, please sign up on the sign-up sheet on the little table in the back of the sanctuary. Thank you. Ladies, come on out Friday, October 30th at 6:30 p.m. in the multipurpose room. Join the ladies' ministry as they read the Word together. They will be reading from the book of Galatians. Hello, brothers and sisters. We will be fasting and praying November 2nd for our presidential election. We will be meeting at the church on November 2nd from 9 to 10 to pray for the election and our church.
Of hell shall not prevail against it. So, you know, I see that Rick Bustamante is here. Look at that. That is awesome. Now, those of you who don't know, he tore his arterial tear. And so, anyway, so it's amazing. I didn't think I was going to see you today, but he had been in the hospital, so it's a great thing to see him, and to see all of you guys too. So we're going to take a moment. We're going to pray, and you know, those of us that work jobs and love the Lord with our money, we're going to give our tithes and offerings, and of course, this gives you your time. If you haven't done so yet, you can just kind of go on your phone and type in, what is it, 99799, and then the letters FLCC on your text part. So call 77977. And so let's go ahead and give to the Lord, and let's pray that, you know, God would be honored through our church, that God would make our church just the most blessed in every way. All right, Lord, thank you for your great goodness, Lord God. And Lord, we are here this morning, Lord, not to go crazy like we're having church, but Lord, to be like recognizing that you are risen from the dead. And we're not just, you know, trying to make church in our own image. We're not trying to do church the way other people do church. And it's all man's creation. But we're trying to just love you, love your word. We're trying to really keep it simple here, Lord God. And so, Lord, we know it's fellowship, it's your word, it's the praises to you. And it's just seeking your face, and it's blessing one another. And so, Lord, we pray that this morning all the sweetness of Christianity would be in this room. Lord, we would take out of this room, Lord, all the sweetness that you have given in the body of Christ. And, Lord, we thank you that Rick is back in church, Lord, after his arterial tear. And we thank you, Lord God, that you are seated, Jesus Christ is seated on the throne, until he puts all of his enemies under his feet. And the last enemy to be put under his feet is death. So we thank you, Lord, that even death will be absolutely under your feet. Lord, we just ask you to bless our tithes and offerings now, as those that still write checks or those that still give cash, which is probably less than 1%. But Lord God, we give it to you, and we just ask you to bless those that give in the offering bag. And then, of course, Lord, the majority who give through their tithing, through giving online, Lord, we ask you to bless that as well. So, Lord, please provide for them. And then we thank you, Lord, for providing also, Lord, for the kingdom of God right here on the corner of Hadley and Milton in Whittier. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to sing a newer song. It's called Heal Our Land, and it's based on the scripture from 2 Chronicles Chapter 7, verse 14, where it says, "If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land." And this song's just really ministered to me lately, just in the times that we're living. And let us look up to the Lord. May we turn from our wicked ways and ask the Lord to heal our land. You take beautiful. Restore, refine, Lord, you're merciful. Church voices only. Spirit of God, breathe on your church, pour out your presence, speak through your word. We pray in every nation, Christ be known, our hope and salvation, Christ alone.
Man. All right, you guys. That was, if you noticed on the writing there, it was Carrie Jobe, K-A-R-I, Jobe, J-O-B-E. And so you want to look that up, Heal Our Land. I want to get that here too, because I want to look it up this week and, you know, pay the 99 cents for it or whatever. And because if this is going to be in the list, then we got to get this one down, right? It's a new one. So get it down. Heal Our Land by Carrie Jobe. I'd like to say a couple of things before I teach. Number one, just about babies. We have a baby room over to the right over here, and so that's pretty neat. And so besides the toddler room. And, you know, the Lord through birth is bringing some babies in. I don't know how close Sean and Alex are to having their baby, but she was kind of walking around the hospital room last night trying to, I guess, bring up the labor. And so I don't know if they sent her home or if she's still in the room or what. I have no idea. But anyway, so to pray for them as they're right there on that precipice of birth. And then secondly, Michael and Imelda, raise your hand right there. Their son, MacGyver and his wife, Olivia, they just had a baby this morning. And now I will tell you, we're going to pray for them because MacGyver said that this is his church and he's coming to church here. But he hasn't been back for a long time. So we're going to pray not only for their baby, we're going to pray that he comes back to church too. So let's pray for that, Lord. We just thank you for this family. We thank you for MacGyver and Olivia, Lord God, and we just pray that you'd bless their little baby this morning and their family. And we also pray, Lord God, that you would just bring them back into the fold, Lord. And we just thank you for them in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, and then also we have Jesse and Kirsty that I have seen here lately. And so Melissa and Rich Christensen, it's her brother. And they just had their baby yesterday. And so... So anyway, let's just pray for the whole baby department, okay? So, Lord, we just pray that whether somebody's out of church or whether somebody's coming back to our church or whether somebody's just out for birth or whatever, Lord, we just, Lord, you said, you know, will you, you know, bring something to the point of birth and not deliver it in Isaiah 66. And so, Lord God, we pray that we would see these deliveries, Lord God, and we'd see you deliver them safely, and thank you, Lord God, for working in these families' lives. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. The other thing that I would like to speak of, and I'd like to speak about voting. Now, I want to speak of that before I teach the word, because, why? Because November 3rd is how soon? It's pretty soon. Okay. So here's what I think. Without, I didn't prep for this or anything like that, but I want to tell you what my thoughts are on it. Okay, number one, things that I'm going to say. If you're a triggered person, which as a Christian you shouldn't be, you should be just able to flow with people and love people. But if you're a triggered person, you know, based on politics, you will be like, oh, I can't listen to Pastor John's message this morning. And that shows that your walk with the Lord is off. I will say that, okay? It shows that, okay? Because you shouldn't be triggered like that. And so, but we should be able to listen to things soundly, and we should be able to listen to things carefully and with understanding and receive it. Now, when we talk about, like, say, the Catholic Church, we talk about the Pope. Do we believe we're supposed to be a part of the Catholic Church? No. Do we believe that the Pope is the head of the church and that he took Peter's place? That's really not biblically nor historically true. And so, no, we don't do that. And so when you read articles like last week about the Pope accepting civil unions, you know, but if I quoted the Pope on something good he said, and then all of a sudden you're going, but he accepted civil unions, you know, whatever. You see how easily we get triggered by religious or political things, and yet we're living in the world, and we can talk about people, and we can talk about things, and we don't have to get so triggered. But anyway, so you have also with politics, and when we talk about religion, you're saying, okay, the Catholic people, you know, they're not the hierarchy, are they? They're not the ones that are teaching that salvation by works. They're not the ones. So there's a lot of Catholic people that simply believe in Jesus, and when they die, they'll go to heaven because they had a simple childlike faith in Christ. They weren't the hierarchy who was teaching that salvation was by works, okay? So God looks at things a little differently than we do, and we get all triggered religiously and everything, but we got to kind of take a breath and slow down, even though we have to also, you know, understand there's truth and there's error, and we, you know, so it's not that we're just so tolerant that we don't, you know, stand for anything, but you have to be tolerant and stand for something. You have to be both, okay? Can you be both? And so then, okay, when it comes to politics, there's two parties in the United States, right? The Democratic and the Republican Party. You know, both of them are not what they were, you know, years ago. Um, and And both of them have lots of corruption in them, you know. And who are they run by? Men. And what type of men? Sinners, right? But as Christians, we don't vote by party. We vote by beliefs and values. Now, both parties do have beliefs and values, maybe some good and some bad in both of them. But when it comes to Christianity, we tend to lean toward that which we know is in Scripture, that which might bother our conscience or that which we would want to see changes in our land based upon what we believe, right? Even though there's other important things too. And so some people vote that are Christian only by what they think is important, but they kind of push the Christian values to the side because they're voting by party and they're voting by what they think is important. And so so when it comes to voting, people can vote however they want. You can have whatever reasons, and the Holy Spirit apparently, you know, could lead somebody to vote based upon something that was important to you. So we don't want, just like with masks or no masks, we don't want to be a church that, you know, is like, okay, well, I chose not to wear my mask, but I'm 6 feet away from somebody, but, you know, you have a mask. Why do you have a mask? Do you not trust God? Well, no. Maybe they might be the one that will get sick, and maybe they have a situation in their life. So meaning, we don't want to be a judgmental church, mask, no mask, Democrat, Republican. We don't want to be judgmental, but we do want to have understanding. And, of course, that would be my point as a pastor, is to bring a little understanding. So I don't have all the things, but I've looked at them well, and I know that on, even if you weren't voting for a person, and I was listening to this girl on the news talking the other day, and she's some person that is the head of some group, and she's like, well, I'm not really voting for Biden because he's only okay. He's just okay, but this was on CNN. But I'm voting for the party and what the party stands for. And so same thing for Republicans. Some people think, well, I don't like this guy's tweets. Actually, I don't mind them because I think it's better to have a civil war of words than it is for bullets to be flying. But I think that, you know, I know when it comes to Israel, Obama was really not behind Israel. This guy is behind Israel. When it comes to churches and even the law about churches and everything, This guy is behind churches. The other side is not the people. Remember, like not the Catholics, but the hierarchy? The other side, the hierarchy, is definitely not there with God, okay? And so when you look at the whole political situation and you look at, you know, just various things like abortion. I heard somebody talking the other day. How could you, if you are really a person who believes that abortion is wrong, how could you vote with a group that believes that you can kill babies all the way up to 9 months? Do you know what I'm saying? Like, so I heard somebody saying that on the news the other day. And so when you listen to the arguments back and forth, and you look at the beliefs and the values that Christians hold, and you look at the possibility of the way things can go from having a republic like the United States of America, and that slowly but surely these other people are creeping in over here that are going to take over the party, and it's going to become a Venezuela kind of situation, you know, of socialism. And when you look at all that as a possibility and a high possibility, you know, I'm not dense and I'm not far away from looking at this stuff and understanding and not just going by the talking points of the news, because I'll tell you what, you guys, I listen to CNN, I listen to Fox, and I listen to MSNBC, and I go back and forth to all of them, so that way I get an equal point of view. And I even read Google News, okay, on the app. And I'm telling you that I take it in, and I'm a Christian. I'm a fair-minded man. I'm a man that you know, just really wants what's right. And so I will say that I know. I mean, you can. I mean, even, you know, it would be hard for you to understand because this is a, you know, a kind and gentle guy, and Trump's this guy that's, you know, just, as they say, bombastic. But I think, you know, I mean, he's my favorite so far, you know, and I totally like the guy. I think he's great. And I think, you know, he's you know, doesn't know the Lord like we have, but maybe now. He just claimed yesterday that he's non-denominational, no longer Presbyterian. So who knows what God's doing in his life. Now, if Biden wins, God could really, Biden claims to be Catholic, but he's not following Christ. But he could become a Christian while he's in office. I mean, God can do anything. So no matter who wins, we're not doomed. We're not doomed, okay? I mean, God's on the throne. But I would say, you know, and anybody who knows me, they know which way I go. You know, I'm definitely right. I'm not a leftist. But I will say that I know there's still a lot of Christians that are over on the side of the left for their own particular reasons. But I want you guys just to really think about it, to really pray about it when it comes to Christian values, because these things will eventually change the country and change your life. And the man will be long gone, and then Pence will be president or whatever. You know what I mean? The man will be long gone, but the things that are happening and the conservative judges that will judge in favor of Christianity, that is going to have a lifetime effect. And so when you do vote, I want you to, if you've never prayed before, I want you to pray and say, Lord, what is it that you value? What is it that's true? And now, God could still have you vote on the other side, because I just don't always know the heart of God on these things. But I would say, you know, as far as if you were just trying to use wisdom from what you know as a Christian, you know, I'd hope that you would think about these things and pray about these things, okay? So I want to say that, because then I won't have guilt later on if the other side wins and I'm very unhappy 2 years from now when the church is being persecuted. And believe me, the church will be persecuted beyond what you've ever seen before. And, you know, you think that all of this, you know, is going to stop, and it's not. It's, you know. So, you know, let's just pray for it right now, because everybody has their views, but we got to find out what the Lord wants. So, Lord, we come before you. And, Lord, I don't sit here, Lord, among my congregation and claim that I'm, you know, the guru of politics. And, Lord, that I know all of that. But, Lord, I know that I've looked at it. And I know, Lord God, what the Bible says. And so I know, Lord, that I couldn't even possibly go the other way based upon all of the things, all of the criteria, Lord, for Christianity. And so, Lord God, I just pray that you would just help each one to vote according to what they pray about in their conscience. And, Lord, if, like, the idea, Lord, of somebody eating meat sacrificed to an idol as opposed to not, if somebody does choose to eat the meat that sacrificed the idol, Lord, that they would just feel good in their own conscience about that, Lord. And that none of us in the church would be judgmental toward one another who voted one way or another, as long as we have a good argument for why we did what we did. And because, Lord, we sometimes do have to give an answer for ourselves. And so, Lord God, please bless our church. Please bless the voting in our country to help save our country, because that song was Heal Our Land. And so, Lord, we're asking you to do that. We know that really politics doesn't heal any land, Republican or Democratic side. We know it's really us as Christians winning people to Christ. And so we just give that to you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so that was my little say on it, okay? So this morning we're going to have a study from the book of Luke chapter 20. So if you would go ahead and turn there, we'll see what the Holy Spirit has to say to us. But let's see, I got to find my study. Now, we put out a call for you guys to try to come early, so that way, you know, you don't have to worry about the parking situation, because the church on the corner, I don't know if it's bought or leased, but I'm guessing it's leased from a big church in Santa Fe Springs over next to La Mirada off of Imperial, and they moved over there. And so we have to kind of make do and figure things out. So hopefully you guys are okay getting in here this morning. All right, so Luke chapter 20. In fact, I'm going to read it from the Bible, not my computer, because I want to just share a few things. Chapter 20, starting in verse 9. It says, "Then he began to tell the people this parable. A certain man planted a vineyard and leased it to vine dressers, and went into a far country for a long time. Now at vintage time, he sent a servant to the vine dressers that they might give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the vine dressers beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And again he sent another servant, and they sent him also, and treated him shamefully, and sent him away empty-handed. And again he sent a third, and they wounded him, and also cast him out. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my beloved son. Probably they will respect him when they see him." But when the vine dressers saw him, they reasoned among themselves, saying, "This is the heir. Come and let us kill him, that the inheritance may be ours." So they cast him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, what will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and destroy those vine dressers and give the vineyard to others. And when they heard it, they said, "Certainly not." And then he looked at them and said, "What then is this that is written? The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Whoever falls on that stone will be broken, but on whomever it falls, it will grind him to powder." And the chief priests and the scribes that very hour sought to lay hands on him, but they feared the people, for they knew that he had spoken this parable against them. So what happened was, Jesus is telling a story. A parable is an illustration. At the end of the story, the chief priests and the elders knew that he was talking about them, that they were the vine dressers. The vine dressers were the ones that leased the land from the owner. And they had vineyards on this land. And on that land, they were supposed to give the servant that the owner would send whatever large portion of that fruit was. So all of the harvesting of it, there was a chunk of it in lease payment that would go to that owner. And who knows, even whatever other money on top of that would go to the owner. And so these guys, for some reason, got the idea that the vineyard, well, that they wanted the vineyard to be theirs. And that we don't really have to listen to or have authority over us, this landowner. In fact, we can pretend like we own it and that he doesn't exist. And anybody that comes our way to bring into question about this, we can just get rid of them. And eventually we just, you know, we're squatters on the land. We can eventually just own it. And so Jesus said he was talking about the chief priests, the elders. So he was talking about those that were part of the kingdom of God among the Jews. And that those people that were the leaders, say, of the temple, the Pharisees and Sadducees and the scribes and all of those kinds of people, and they were actually teaching the people. They were setting up the temple, you know, getting church ministry ready for people. But they themselves were, most of them were not really following the Lord and were not really looking at Scripture as far as seeing the coming of the Messiah and Jesus and accepting it, because they wanted religion their way. They you know, just like the cleaning of the temple. I think you saw the video last week of me sharing that. I think it was last week. But, you know, you see Jesus doing this because they were doing things their way. They were selling the sacrifices and all this in the temple, which was not God's way. They were supposed to pick of their herds and their flocks and the best and bring it. And so it turns out that people, after a while, and it's like I said, even with religion, and so whether it be evangelical churches or even the Catholic Church, after groups get to be around for a very long time, they add a lot of additions of man. And so then it becomes really man-made religion, the religion of man. And so all of these additives, they think that this is our thing. This is our party. This is my house. And yeah, like God's over here. Well, yeah, it's about God, but it's ours. We're doing it. And so the landowner, in order to, you know, have them give an account, however often that he could send a servant to them, he would send the servant, and that represented the servants over the years, the various prophets, and then finally John the Baptist, whom they killed, and then of course the apostles. And so there's a picture that God is sending his servants saying, "Okay, time to give account. Give me what is mine." Now, he wasn't requiring everything. He leased the land to them. You know, we have a church building here. Well, guess what? We can pick out our own paint color. I mean, we can pray about it, but God's pretty much okay with that. He's just saying, you know, give me what's mine. You know, when you come in, make sure that, you know, the glory due my name is happening here. That there's that spiritual fruit, the praises to God, and people just, you know, taking from the source and developing fruit in their life as their vines are bulging with fruit. And so this is what the Lord expects. It's something that the Lord is looking for. But when the Lord came and he sent a servant, then another servant, then another servant, and they sent him away, and even one, I think the third one, he sent away shamefully. So they did something to him. I mean, I know in the book of Samuel and such about, I think it was even after David, but the men were sent back to maybe Solomon, and their pants were cut off at the buttocks, it says, and they were they shamed the men that were sent to them. And so whatever would have been a shame, they were shamed, you know, coming back and empty-handed. You know, I'm serious. We went there, we really did talk to them, and they're like, they cast us out, and they wouldn't give us anything. Now, I'll tell you what, if you're a renter like that, and you're just relying on the government because, like, well, we're waiting for the next stimulus check to come in because they're not going to be able to kick me out, but yet you're using your money on who knows what, and you're not even giving half of your rent, you know what? You're as bad as those guys, maybe, okay? I don't know your story, but maybe. And then also, you know, I mean, there you could be the landowner that isn't understanding or compassionate. But this landowner deserved what he was to get. He deserved to receive what was his from his land, from, you know, what they owed him because they're using his land. And so let's just say here that our land is our temple, okay? Head to toe. Your body is your land. And God's going, you know, I'll let you have this for lease, you know, for so many years. But you need to bring me something. You need to honor me. You need to give me of the fruit of your life, of what would come from it. Now, if you don't, because it says that faith without works, without fruit, is dead. So you find in the end, no matter how much you said Jesus, 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 and that you were a Christian, that somewhere along the line you were deceiving yourself and you really didn't have true biblical saving faith, because true biblical saving faith produces fruit. And so in the end, what happens to the hypocrites, he says, is they get cast into outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So then you talk about God's people, you know, well, aren't all the Jews going to be saved? Well, at least not these Jews that Jesus was talking to. He says, no, you guys, he goes, you guys are going to be, at the end of the chapter, you saw, or the end of the story, he says, you guys are going to be destroyed. Absolute destruction on the one that holds back from God what is rightfully his. And that's exactly what they were doing. And so when they realized it was him, themselves, that he was talking about, even though the scripture had already spoke of this, of them wanting to destroy him, but all the more, the last week of his life, I mean, they were in a frenzy. I mean, they were, I mean, you know, how somebody gets angry and then it's like kind of up to here and it's like, it was bursting from them. It's like, we have got to destroy this guy because he is a threat. The light is a threat to the darkness, and he is a threat to everything that we believe in and we want to do, because we want to do it our way. And so this is us. This is it. This is ours. And so finally, at the end of the story, number four, who does he send? It says he thinks to himself, and he says, well, you know, surely they'll respect my son, you know, because that's equal to me going and getting what needs to be gotten. And so he sends a son. He's not thinking in the story, there's not this thought like, well, they're going to kill my son. But it says that they cast him out and they killed him. So there was an absolute disregard for the owner. Really, the disregard for God. Disregard for Christ. You don't honor the son, you don't honor the father either. So it was an absolute disregard for the owner by killing his son, sending away the servants empty-handed. And I'll tell you what, if we are empty-handed, not the servants, because the servants were persecuted, and they weren't able to come and give the Lord what was due because they put emptiness in their hands. But for us, when the Lord comes to us and we're supposed to give it, we are not supposed to be empty-handed. And so whatever that is, so, you know, you go over those typical things, time, talents, and treasures, whatever it is, I'm giving the Lord my time, I'm giving the Lord my abilities, I'm giving the Lord all of my hard working everything. I got to give him my energy. I got to give him my life. Because there's only a certain amount of hours in a day. There's only a certain amount of years in a life. And we don't know when that is. I mean, you know, a few weeks, actually a month ago, over a month ago now, when I fell under that pomegranate tree, I wasn't realizing when I got home from a root canal that day that I was going to be in bed for 1 month, except for going to the doctors and a couple other things that I did, and that, you know, and paid the price for doing it, because your foot has to be lifted the whole time. And now I am at the foot lifting time of this message too. So what happened was, so yesterday was my first longest day out, and I, what did I do? I walked on my crutches. Walked on them. Yes, I stood on them. No, I walked on the crutches, and I got home, and then by the time I got home, it was so swollen and so bursting that I was like, oh my gosh, okay, I'm sick. And so then I had to go back into bed. But boy, didn't I look cool, you know, out there walking on these crutches, you know. And so empty-handed. My life, I've noticed that all of my energy is going into the healing of this. I'm out of breath. Getting from the car down the stairs into here, I was out of breath. But you know what? I would rather burn out for Jesus than burn out for the world. And, you know, people burn out for their families. They burn out for their jobs. But, you know, where's your priority, right? Where's our priority? And so may the Lord awaken in us a full-handedness. Lord, here is what is yours. Here is what is owed to you. Here is what is coming from my land that I'm leasing from you, my life. Here it is. And then of course, the whole church building, and when we talk about the church building, we can talk about all the church buildings worldwide and all of that land and all of that property. I mean, and I don't remember, I taught it to you guys several weeks ago, but I don't know if it was just in the U.S. or not, but I mean, just, you know, the church was, I think, it was either in the U.S. or in the world, but it was the largest, 15th largest economy in the world, the church, as far as the amount of money that comes through the church. I mean, now, I don't know where all that goes, and I don't know, you know, what impact every church has or anything like that, but it's interesting. And so imagine when the church gives an account of being the 15th largest economy in the world, and it's like, what did you guys do? Now, this first group, the Jews, they screwed up, didn't they? It's ours. We're going to kick all these guys away, and we're going to do it our way. We're not going to give you what's due your name. And so they're doing their thing. And so what does he say at the end of the story? He says, then we're going to take it away. Doesn't it say that? Okay, I feel like it does. Then they heard it. They said, certainly not. It's written, whoever falls on this stone, chief priest. Okay. Therefore, the owner of the vineyard due to them. It says in verse 16, he will come and destroy those vine dressers. Oh, yeah, and give the vineyard to others. Do you see that in verse 16? He'll give the vineyard to others. Well, that's what he did, guys. Church, he did that. We are the others that are mentioned there. He took it from the Jews, and he gave it to others. But being the 15th largest economy in the world, are we doing it? I don't think so. I think we're just as bad as the Jews now. You know, I think it's only 1% of Christians. We're talking about born-again Christians. At one point, it was 2%. 2 to 3%. And so I can't remember where I got the 1% from, so fact-check me on that. But I think, but the majority of true believers never share their faith. Is that pretty heavy? And so when you think about that, you realize, are we really bringing him the fruit? Because the fruit for us is telling people that Jesus loves them, right? He demonstrated his love on the cross, and he'll forgive your sins. I mean, that's the fruit. If you're not telling somebody sometime, at least once a month or something, I'm not putting a schedule to it. I really don't know what God's schedule is, okay? But I mean, if you're not talking about Jesus, then you're missing it. But I go to church, but I serve at church, and Jesus is going to say, this you do, but this you have left undone. You know what I'm saying? And so bear fruit. And I know that the fruit is love, joy, peace, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, and, you know, self-control. Yeah, that too, Jesus' character. But if you really have Jesus' character, what are you doing? You're talking about the kingdom. You're talking about the kingdom. That's all he did, right? He loved, did good, went about doing good, it says, and preached the kingdom, that it was at hand. Okay, verse 9. Verse 9 of Luke chapter 20. It says, then he began to tell the people this parable. A certain man planted a vineyard and leased it to vine dressers and went into a far country for a long time. Everybody, just for fun, because I'm the teacher and you get to copy me, just say far country for a long time. Okay. Do you think that Jesus is kind of talking about, in all of the stories he told, he always said, even the point where he talked about in various stories about going away, the owner going away, it was always for a long time. So 2,000 years is a really long time, right? So giving charge over something, you know, I mean, for them, you know, they had their age of the law. We have our age of grace. Our age of grace is, so far, guys, a couple thousand years. This is a long time. So if you picture God going away, the owner, and he's like, okay, I put these people in charge. I'm going to kick back over here and require something of them. I'm not just, you know, not involved, but I'm going to kick back over here and let them do their religious thing because that's what they're supposed to do. I put them in charge of the vineyard. They got to, you know, clean the shovels for the offerings, and they've got to set up the candle oil and all this stuff and invite the people in and count the offerings or whatever, you know, everything that's supposed to honor me. They got to do it. And so God just kind of left it alone. He, you know, the rules were very simple. Just run the church. And the Jews ran it their way. And then he opened it up later on when he says, okay, I'm giving it over to the church, the Gentiles, and then run the church. And then when you look, there's so many different kinds of churches, right, that run it in so many different kinds of ways. Because he actually, even though you look at Timothy, he kind of did leave it open for different ways of running churches. It wasn't absolutely, you know, set in stone. It has to be, well, the pastor is like Moses and everybody else is like the elders of Israel. And, you know, but when you look, there are churches that are ran just by a group of elders. There's churches that are senior pastor predominant. There are, you know, churches that are run by the congregation. You're like, yeah, that sounds good. You know, but those churches always boot out the pastor every couple of years, so it didn't sound good to me. But, you know, it's true. Congregational churches are a loss. So yes, I do have my judgments about politics and religion. And so yes, when it comes to different kinds of churches, God left it kind of open. But the main thing was the main thing, the preaching of the gospel and the churches being filled with people that are, you know, believing and studying, getting saved and worshiping and that kind of thing. And that is what has to be happening, or we are like those vine dressers, cast them out, take them out, destroy them. So that means this is moving by itself. That means that God is not just looking at us individually. He's looking at us as a church. He's looking at us as First Love Calvary Chapel and also part of the whole thing, the whole kingdom of God thing. And are we making it happen? Are we making the landowner happy? Or is he displeased with empty-handedness? And then he's trying to figure out, okay, but I went as far as sending my son to them, and they're not even respecting my son. And so what will he do? That's what it says at the end of that verse I read, I think verse 16. What will he do? You know, what else can he do? It's like these are all fakes. The Jewish leaders became fakes, worshiping God with their mouth. Their heart was far from him. And then the church becomes a bunch of fakes. And then, of course, that's why people always get turned off by religion, right? Because oftentimes it all just becomes one big fake thing. It doesn't mean that the truth isn't there. It doesn't mean that it's not real. It doesn't mean Jesus didn't die on the cross. It just means that the people themselves just start doing it their way, their thing, and not God's thing. Now, here's God's thing in verse 9. It says, then he began to tell the people this parable. A certain man planted a vineyard and leased it to vine dressers, and he went into a far country for a long time. When we start a new church, you know what it's called? It's called a church plant. You know, when you have a new family, you had a new baby. You're starting a new family. When you start at a new job or somebody who's creating a new company, I've got a new business going. It's all new. We like it when things are new. And there's a lot of ingenuity, a lot of creativity, a lot of excitement when something is new. But then after a while, people just start kind of putting the rules aside, you know, as far as the structure that God would like, and just start going, you know, we're very comfortable with this, and we're very familiar with the way we've been doing things, and I don't care if it's 20 years later and things, you know, society's changed a little bit, we're just going to do it this way. We don't care if anybody new comes in, because you know what, we just like our group of 20 old people, and we want to die together, and if nobody else, you know, is able to, you know, buy this church building, well, then the county can take it over, and it can become a museum, you know, whatever. And I mean, so, you know, you look at the reality of religion, and it's like, it's pretty sick, isn't it? I mean, and I know too much, because I've been around too long, and I've seen it. But what the Lord plants, he expects it to bring forth fruit. So righteousness, peace, joy, all that, you know, the fruit of righteousness. Lord, help us as a church. Help us as an American church. Help us as a church in the world. Help us as individuals to not just be casting Jesus out. Because guess what? Jesus died outside of the camp, and he's always been out. It says they cast him out. They cast his servants out. Well, guess what? It says in Revelation chapter 3, maybe verse 20. It sounds familiar, that's why I'm saying it. You'll have to look it up. Somebody tell me yes if I'm right. But he says, it's not in my notes, I just thought of it just now. But he says, I stand at the door and knock. It's part of my message, I just didn't know where it's at. I stand at the door and knock. And if any man hears my voice and opens the door, and maybe it says opens the door, you know, I'll come into him and sup with him and he with me. And so you know what it's saying there? It's saying there's a church, it's written to a church, that he's knocking on the door of a church and they're not letting him in. But if anybody does let me in, I will come in and we'll have a meal together, we'll have a feast together. And you look at the name of the church in Revelation and everything, he's writing to a church. So does religion leave Jesus out? Yes. Did the vine dressers leave Jesus out? Yes. And we have to make sure, we have the name Jesus on the wall. Well, we have Jesus on our wall, you know, but you walk out of church and Jesus is, you know, trailing behind you. You know, you've got him in your back pocket, not in your heart. You know what I'm saying? And I mean, Jesus needs to be front and center. And because he is coming back from his long journey and far country. And it is going to be, you know, a heck of a long time later. But we know that we are living in those times because we are in the signs of the times. And I'll tell you what, the time clock started in 1948. You all know when Israel became a nation. That is the time clock right there. So we are there. Israel was not in existence before. So it couldn't have been the time clock. Israel is in existence now. It is the time clock. And so he's getting ready to give an account of his vine dressers. We're the new vine dressers. We're the new ones that have the lease. And we better have something to give. So are we taking care of what God has given us? The pruning and the fertilizing and the bearing of the fruit. You know, sometimes bearing fruit can hurt us. This is a pomegranate from the pomegranate tree at my house. That I was picking pomegranates. I was not on a ladder. I was standing on my feet. Yes, I broke my leg while standing on my feet. However you can do that. But it was done. And so, but you know, I'll tell you what. In my backyard, and I actually, on the front of the 9 o'clock message, I have the pomegranate tree in the behind me as I'm giving the message. But I saw the other day a blue jay because I was still in bed. I saw a blue jay pecking away at one of those pomegranates. I'm like, oh my gosh, it's stealing my pomegranates. And then, then our dog was like looking, and it was like a squirrel, you know, and it's like, going, oh man, that thing's eating a pomegranate. You know, meaning there are things that will steal our fruit, our joy, our what we would want to offer to God, because our time, we don't have time, because all these things are stealing my time, so then I can't do this for God. All these things are stealing my attention, so I can't focus on God. And, you know, the little blue jays and the squirrels, the demons, the cute demons. Have you ever heard that phrase before? Did I just make that up? That's horrible. Don't ever repeat it. They're not cute. Okay. Cut that one out. Okay. Ed, cut it out. Okay. But this thing destroyed me. I was bedridden 99% of the time, even though you saw me come into church here two of the weeks. But I couldn't come in last week, and I couldn't come in Wednesday. It was like, if I could, everything I wanted to, but I couldn't. You know, because this leg and the swelling, and then the swelling makes your whole body feel sick. And so, but I'll tell you, sometimes it hurts to bear fruit. Sometimes it hurts to pick fruit. There was right above the pomegranate tree is a avocado tree. And about 2 years ago, I was picking avocados, and I brought a bag to the church, but I fell off the ladder, just three rungs, and my hand slid on the top of it. It didn't have that plastic on the top. It was just cut metal, aluminum, and it cut open my hand. My hand was like, if you're scared of blood, hold your ears. It was like squirting out like a hose. And I'm going, oh my gosh. And it was 6 o'clock. Church was at 7. So I was able to close it up, wash it out, and bandage it really tight and get to church and teach and tell everybody I couldn't stay because I had to get to the emergency to get stitches. And I did that. Okay? And I found out, though, when I was picking these things, that the doctor said that picking fruit is a very common injury in emergency rooms. I mean, if anybody works in emergency room, this is Kaiser that said that, so who knows, but that's what this guy said. And so, in other words, bearing fruit isn't a beautiful thing always, and giving fruit isn't a beautiful thing always. Like, these guys came back empty-handed, right? So, in other words, they were humiliated, they were shamed. And the Lord understood that they couldn't give him anything. They understood that there are times that the ministry is tough. Bearing fruit is tough. There are times where things aren't working out quite the way that we want them to. It's like I was talking to, you know, one pastor, and it's like, well, but, you know, it's a newer church, but last week only this many people came. I go, that's okay. I was talking to another pastor who has a bigger church, you know, the other day, and he said, same's happening at our church right now too. And, you know, and when churches are there, not because of peer pressure and pastor pressure, but when Christians are there, not because of groupthink, but because they just have a walk with Jesus and they want to come, for some reason, a lot of people take advantage of that kind of freedom. But at the same time, you have to remember that we're living in the coronavirus season and that a lot of church members don't feel comfortable yet, you know, because their cousin died of coronavirus or their parent died and, you know, that kind of stuff. And so we're living in heavy times, for sure. But we're living in times where the planting of a church, the planting of something for God is hard. It's hard to bear fruit. It's hard, like, but Lord, I have nothing to give you. You know what I told that pastor friend? I said, when we were a new church, and I was standing, we had a window there, and then it was a wall for a long time after we got rid of the window, because it's a long story, but we did get rid of the window. And there was a window half the size of that window, and it used to be the bike room in there for the YMCA, you know, where you pedaled your bikes, and you could look through at them playing basketball while you're pedaling your bike. And I'm looking through at our service in here. This is, you know, when we were a much newer church, and we're just renting the facility. And I was like mad at all the empty seats. It's like, look at all those empty seats. And the Lord's just going, well, instead of being mad at the empty seats, why don't you just pray for the people that are there? You know? And so, and it was real. I mean, it was a real moment. You know, you can have those real moments as Christians. And so there were like 37 people there. And so instead of worshiping, I was praying for, and I couldn't even get through the 37 people. It was like, it was too much work. It was, you know what I mean? Like going, oh my gosh, I can't even pray for 37 people. I mean, why should there be, you know, more? And so God knows what kind of fruit we can bear, what we can do, you know, for him. And we just need to, We just need to be open, and we need to not be mad at what God's doing. Well, only that many came. And I understand it's a lot of pressure on pastors, but you got to get the right perspective about fruit, for sure, because it's tough days that we're living in. But Jesus, this was the last week of his life. Imagine that. I mean, you guys, some people think, oh, you're coming and teaching with a broken leg or whatever. Well, I mean, you know, people go to work with broken legs, I guess, you know, whatever. People just, you know. And so Jesus was working his last week, and he is teaching about this parable the last week and making them matter the last week of his life. And some people would just turn over on their bed because, well, I'm going to die this week, so let me just sleep in a little bit this morning. But Jesus wasn't, man. He was hardcore teaching, pouring his life into everybody the last week. And it was about planning the kingdom. There's a scripture that says, and I'm going to read it to you, and getting through this a little quicker. I'm going to end in a few minutes. But it says in Romans 11, 17, and if some of the branches were broken off, that was the Jews broken off, and you, being a wild olive branch, any of you feel like a little wild olive branch this morning? It says, and you were grafted in among them, among the branches that were broken off. You know, Jesus says that his will in John 15 was that you'd go and bear much fruit and that your fruit would remain. But the branches who don't bear fruit and that are dead branches are broken off and are withered and then are just good for nothing but to be burned in the fire because there's no fruit. So good for nothing but to be burned in the fire. In other words, a fake. Having what would look like something promising coming from it, but it's really dead. Do you look promising, but you're really dead? This is the time to awake, you who sleep, and rise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. This is the day to, you know, rise up and be the children of God and to be those wild olive branches, meaning God brought you from that wild club and put you in church. God brought you from being wild and crazy and put you in church. Now, some of the church members that are the older church members that are the more choice and more, balanced church members that have been around for a while, they're like, man, that they still got a little wild gene going on in them there, you know. But you know what? You're grafted in. And yeah, you still got that old nature that gets stirred, but you're grafted in. You're alive on the vine. And then in Jeremiah 2:21, it says, Jeremiah says, I had planted you, and of course God's speaking to him, I had planted you like a choice vine of sound and reliable stock, like a really good seed. And our seed is the word of God, right? It's good seed. It says, how then did you turn against me into a corrupt and wild vine? How'd you like go back to the world and just become wild again and walk away from me? And that's from the New International Version, if Nordina's showing a verse there, because she would be showing it to you from the New King James Version. So when we plant anything, a family, a church, or even a company, and what you intended for it to be, eventually it could get out of control and not be what you wanted it to be. And God's own vineyard became like that. Because God gave them freedom and they ran in a direction that he never intended. Verse 10. Now at vintage time, he sent a servant. That's verse 10. Then he sends another servant, verse 11. Okay? Vintage time means season. It was a season for rent to be due. We're at the end of October. Rent's almost due, guys, or mortgages or whatever. And so it was a season for the fruit to be due. 2 Timothy 4:2, be instant, in season and out of season. Preach the word. Ready to rebuke and exhort and, you know, to do God's work, in season or out of season. But when Jesus saw the fig tree that was out of season and that it didn't have at least one fig for him, he rebuked the fig tree, cursed it, and it withered up and died. That is what he thinks of fruitlessness. That's what he thought of those in Israel, the vine dressers, that had nothing to offer and were unwilling to give it. And then verse 12, it says, and again he sent a third, and they wounded him also and cast him out. Well, let me tell you, wounding does go on in the church. It does. There are those that are of the flesh and those that are of the spirit, and people wound one another. And maybe one day you are in the flesh and you're wounding those that are in the spirit. And so we have to understand that, ministry hurts. Bearing fruit hurts. Being in church hurts. There are definitely wounds that take place. But these guys should have known that this land was not their own, that we are not our own, that we've been bought with a price. The Lord makes every effort to make sure that we could be productive. Even if we seem hopeless, he'll say, no, give it one more year. Let's fertilize around John. Let's knock him over under the tree. Not saying God did that, but, you know, break a leg. You know, whatever it takes. Because, you know, it is interesting. It is interesting, the lessons that we learn. You know, through Bobby back there, you know, I mean, like, when I was absolutely immobile, and I'm partially immobile now, immobile, if I can say it, you know, you have to trust in another person, right? And so we have to be immobile as Christians in a sense of trusting completely in the Lord to bear fruit. And there are things that maybe we just don't see. Like, I didn't understand everything my wife was going through until all of a sudden I'm in bed and I'm out of breath just going to the bathroom and coming back. You know what I mean? Like, there's things that you just don't know that God still has to teach you, that you have to, and he doesn't cause the situations, but he uses the situations. They're all part of his divine plan, even though life happens. And so, you know, but the Lord makes it possible for us to bear fruit upward and to take root downward and to have something to offer him. And he puts us in a good environment. This is a good environment. The Bible is a good environment. I think Pastor John's an okay environment, because I've talked and I teach and I've taught to a lot of pastors, and you realize there's a lot of whacked pastors out there, and I'm only half whacked, so it's like, you know, you're okay here. I'm telling you, you're in good hands, okay? And then in this one story, maybe it will produce next year, and if it doesn't, then chop it down. There is a point. If something just proves to be worthless, there is a point where it's like, okay, chop it down. Personally, as you look at your life right now, does fruitlessness, if you were to examine yourself and say, you know what, I am fruitless toward God, does that mean anything to you spiritually? Does it hit you? I will say that trials, it says, produce patience. And we count it all joy. Joy is the fruit as we go through various trials. Sometimes we don't produce certain fruit until we go through the trial. Just like a tea bag, you put it, you know, say it's an herbal fruit tea bag. The flavor doesn't come out until it's in hot water, right? And the aroma and everything. And so sometimes we are going to really let it out in the way that God wants us to. And there's things that we still don't have in us until we go through that particular trial. And it all becomes part of our testimony. This was when I was an insolent man and I was persecuting the church. But then Christ took me, who was one born out of season, even though I was of a choice vine, I was of the stock of Israel, but I didn't really know God, and he had to bring about getting me on the ground to wake me up, to show me who I really needed to be serving. And so may the Lord awaken us this morning to glorify him and to let our church, our lives, not be like the Jews that were worthy of only destruction, but that we will, you know, be the ones that the Lord will say, well done, thou good and faithful servants. Not don't be cast out, but enter in to the joy of the Lord. But they did cast Jesus out. And you know what the Bible says in Hebrews 13? That we need to go to him who is outside of the camp. We need to go to Jesus who was crucified outside of the camp. And then let's close in just reading the rest. Okay, verse 17, it says, and he looked at them and said, what then is this that is written? The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. I'm the one that holds up the building. I'm the chief cornerstone. And you guys rejected the chief cornerstone of the building. Verse 18, whoever falls onto that stone will be broken. Well, you know what? Sometimes we have to cast ourselves on that stone and allow God to do the breaking of the alabaster flask for the aroma to really be loosed. And then it says, but on whomever that cornerstone falls, it will grind him to powder. I'd rather be thrown against the stone and be broken and be used by the Lord still than to have the stone crush me to powder, which means the destruction that he was talking about. And then in verse 19, it says, and the chief priests and the scribes that very hour sought to lay hands on him, but they feared the people, for they knew that he had spoken this parable against them. That's the end of the story. Man, what if Jesus spoke a parable against you? But I am a Jew. I'm a son of Abraham. I'm a child of God. Yeah, but you're really not honoring the Son of God. And I know that you guys know a lot of people that believe in God, but they're not going to make it to heaven if they don't honor the Son of God. So we gotta preach Jesus. Let's go ahead and pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for the Bible this morning. Thank you, Lord, that you take a lot of wild olive branches and a lot of whacked pastors and all that kind of stuff and use them all in your kingdom, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are so faithful to graft in all of us, Lord, and to make the church quite a bunch. Very interesting bunch, but it's your bunch, Lord. And so, Lord, may we give ourselves to you this morning. We give First Love Calvary Chapel to you this morning, Lord God. May you come and taste and enjoy the fruit of your vine. In Jesus' name, amen. And if anybody would like to receive Christ, rededicate their life to Christ, to repent of their sins, to say a prayer of repentance, to turn to God, to either come back to Jesus this morning or to ask him into your heart, I'd like Chris to come on over here right now and to my left, and Matt to come over to here to my left right now, and Demas to come over to my left right now, and just go up to any one of them and pray with them and to receive Christ or rededicate your life to Christ. If you need prayer for something, turn to somebody next to you before you leave and go, you know what, I got a court trial coming up. I've got this or that, and get some prayer. Be a Christian at church too. All right, let's sing to the Lord.
Jesus, Lord of heaven, who I do not deserve, the grace that you have given, and the promise of your word, Lord, I stand in wonder. Sacrifice you made, with mercy beyond measure, my debt you freely paid. Your love is deeper than any ocean. Oh, I do not deserve the grace that you have given and the promise of your word. Lord, I stand in wonder at the sacrifice you made. Mercy beyond measure, my debt you freely paid. Your love is deeper than any ocean high. Your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Your love is deep. Your love is wide. Your love is great. Your love is high. Your love is all we ever need. Your love is all we need. Your love is all we need. Your love is all we need. 'Cause your love is deeper than any ocean, higher than the heavens reaches, beyond the stars in the sky. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds. Jesus, your love has no bounds.
Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great rest of your day, and we'll see you next week. God bless you.
Judge who's on the throne. Search me, try me, see if there be any wicked way in me. Absolve me, forgive me, and by your blood declare me not guilty.